Good evening, everyone. So this is my name is Priyanka Zundre, and I'm working in BNHS CEC as education officer. So we are glad to welcome you all in this very first online session on basic bird identification and bird watching. Before the session begins, I will introduce you to the BNHS and CEC. So BNHS, Bombay Natural History Society. We are pan-India. I hope everyone can listen to me, right? Can someone confirm? Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, you are audible.
Thank you. So we are a pan-India organization. We are working in wildlife conservation and research from last 136 years. And CEC, basically CEC is Conservation Education Center, is the education wing of BNHS. Our center is in Goregaon East, inside Film City area, where we conduct educational activities like nature trail, online hybrid courses, eco birthday celebration for more than 20 years. I would like to introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Raju Kasambe. Raju sir, can we?
Yes.
He is assistant director in BNHS CEC Conservation Education Center. He's been with BNHS from last 10 years, and he has many. He is the author of many books like Important Bird Areas of Maharashtra, Threatened Birds of Maharashtra, Maharashtra Ki Phulpakhre, Indian Grey Hornbill, and many more. So his area of interest is birds and butterflies. Apart from that, he is active on many websites like eBirds and I Found Butterflies. So yeah.
Okay.
Raju sir, thank you so much for joining. Over to you, Raju sir.
Hi everybody. Good evening. I hope everybody is safe at home, and we decided to start this series of online webinars for amateur naturalists and nature lovers from BNHS. So thank you, Priyanka. Priyanka is hosting this webinar today, and I welcome you all. So we have a center that is Pune Conservation Education Center in Mumbai, that is CEC. And just like YouTube, there is a small advertisement. We run online hybrid courses from CEC. Our first one is leadership course in biodiversity conservation. Then we have a basic course in ornithology. These courses are 11 months long. Then we have basic course in herpetology for 4 months, basic course in butterflies.
I guess there is a connection issue at the Raju sir's end. So I would like to continue this. So as I was saying, we have some courses, online hybrid courses. We conduct every year, that is leadership course, ornithology course, herpetology course, and butterfly course and botany. So in that, we actually...
Can you see a bird? Many people don't know that your birds, like the house sparrow, if you observe the house sparrows, what you observe is, I saw 10 house sparrows, 50 house sparrows. But what do they do? House sparrows take 3 types of bath every day. 3 types of bath. They take water bath, they take dust bath, they take sun bath. Beaters, green beaters. It's a common bird. They take 3 types of bath. Water bath, dust bath, sun bath. So it is so interesting. I mean, many of us have never seen sparrows taking dust bath. You might have seen taking the water bath. Sorry, I was muted. Okay. Then you need to observe in detail, like what was the shape of the beak, for example. And the shape of the beak is very important in the classification of birds, in understanding the birds, in understanding what they eat. If you know what should be the shape of the bird, and you see the shape of the bird, you can easily tell what the bird is eating and should be eating. For example, these are granivorous birds. Look at the beak. All they have conical beak. It's like conical. and very strong with a broad, very broad base towards the face. You look conical beak. So that means they have very strong beak. So they are using to break something that is grains. So they eat grains. These are granivorous birds: sparrows, minions, bunting grouse, finches. They eat grains, cereal crops, the grass seeds. Then there are birds which eat a lot of fruits, like the hornbills, parakeets, quails, and marbles. So they have seen even in eating fruits, they have so many types of beaks. So the parakeet is expert in digging out the pulp from a papaya or a custard apple, which a quail won't be able to do as expertly as the parakeet. The coppersmith and hornbill has to eat the fruit whole, just engulf or swallow the fruit whole. So that's the adaptation they have. And parakeet is the only bird which can hold a fruit in its feet and then feed. Other birds can do it. Then the beak types. So birds which feed on nectar. You might have seen a lot of documentaries about hummingbirds on National Geography. Everybody is familiar with hummingbirds, but nobody is familiar with our own hummingbird. That is the sunbird, which I have shown here one. So when somebody tells me this, that I saw a hummingbird in my garden, I'm so happy, because that person who is not a non-birder has observed it so keenly that the bird feeds on nectar and hovers around the flower. That has to be complimented. So I tell him, yes, perfect. You said hummingbird, but only the thing is, hummingbirds are not found in India. That's a sunbird. They are very similar. No problem. You start observing, it's very good observation. So these are parallel. It's an excellent example of convergent evolution. Then the flower picker and the oriental white eye. You look at the beak, especially made for getting nectar from the flowers. Look at the beak of these sunbirds, and I again compared with hummingbirds, because that helps us in remembering. Then there are birds which feed on fish, like the cormorants. Cormorants catch fish. So if you give me a fish, even a dead fish, I cannot hold it in my hand. It just slips away, even if it is dead. But the cormorant can catch a live fish. It just chases the fish under the water and gets it. So it must have something special. So the beak is designed in such a way that the fish doesn't slip from its beak. So it has got serrations or teeth. So it catches the fish perfectly and the fish can't escape. So that's the adaptation. Then we have kingfishers. Beautiful kingfishers. You might be doing kingfisher. We have mineral water and we have other brands also people are more interested in nowadays. They are not getting because of lockdown. That kingfisher. Okay. So the kingfisher is an expert in diving and getting the fish which is swimming underwater. Here is a sequence of photographs showing how the common kingfisher gets the fish. And there is another bird like a river turtle. Like a river tern, which also dives, yeah, but shallow. It's a shallow diving. It's a shallow diving and gets fish. So, and there are woodpeckers, which are experts. The beak is strongest in woodpeckers. And they can even drill through the trunk of a tree or a wood. And that's this type of beak is known as chisel. Then we have raptors, are the birds of prey. That means they eat flesh. So they must have beak which is powerful and hooked and can tear the flesh. So we have raptors. And raptors are like hawks, falcons, sikra, kestrels. These are all raptors. And among the raptors, we have some birds like the owls, which are nocturnal raptors, but they have the similar beak. So they feed in the night. And then among the raptors, we have vultures, which feed on the day. But also they need to tear the flesh. So they are also raptors. Then we have birds which feed by probing into the mud, like this spoon beam, ibis, curly sandpiper. So look at the type of beaks. Even for probing mud, they have so many types of beaks. And this is a beautiful illustration I found on the internet. See, look at the length of the waders. Waders means long-legged birds which feed in mud. So look at the length of their beak. So how they can go to the depth in the mud and reach out to the various types of animals hiding in the mud. So this is how differentiation and adaptation in beaks helps them in feeding on various types of food. Then there are crows and tree pies. These are generalist feeders. Generalist means omnivores. They can feed on anything, like they carry on roti, water, even on flesh, everything. And there are one more expert, that is flamingos. Flamingos feed only on microalgae in water. So, and they're being specially designed. You can see here, that's known as filter feeding or sieve feeding. And then we have flycatchers. Flycatchers are the big, looks like, it looks like tiny, but when it opens, it is big. That's known as gape. So the gape is big. So when they are trying to catch an insect, the gape needs to be bigger. And of course, we have frog mouth. Frog mouth, you look at the big, it looks like small, but when it opens like big jaw. So that is the trick, because it has to fly, it has to catch insects and they fly in the night when they can't really see. And that's why the big, when it opens, or the gap is bigger than actually you feel it is. And cattle egrets are also insectivorous birds. Then we have the various types of feet. Look at the feet. These are webbed feet, like the ducks or river terns and flamingos, and even common coop. These are the birds which need to walk in the mud as well as they need to swim. So both purposes they can use this. Then we have birds known as perching birds or the passerines. These are the commonest birds which are around us, like the sparrows and crows. So these are birds, these have a special mechanism. As soon as the branch touches, so the toes close. So when they are sleeping, even the bird is dead and you touch here, the toes close automatically. These birds are known as perching birds. Crows, babblers, pigeons, bulbuls, all these common birds are the birds which use perching mechanism, and they are known as passerines. Then we have some birds which have a very long toes, and those are specially adapted so that they can walk on aquatic vegetation. So one of them is the jacana, bronzewing jacana and pheasant jacana, then water wrens, moor wrens, swamp wrens. These are the birds which have a very long toes, and they can walk on floating vegetation, like lotus or water lilies. They can easily walk. Then we have special talons of raptors. So raptor means birds of prey. And they have very powerful talons, means nails. And they can catch anything they can manage. Like owls are experts in catching rats and mice in the night. Osprey is expert in catching fish. Just imagine catching fish with its feet. And the fish is in the water. So still it can catch, and the fish won't sleep. So that's the mechanism of the talons, such a powerful talon. Then there are all the raptors which we mentioned are about the hooked beak. They are the birds of prey, and they have such powerful talons, like the eagles, falcons, hawks, kestrels, shikra, and kites and owls. Then we have birds like the herons and egrets, which walk in mud. So they have a little bit of longer toes, but they do. They also perch in trees. They also walk in mud. And we have birds like woodpeckers. They need to climb trees. They walk vertically. So what they have? Two toes up, two toes down. So four toes are divided. Like that. And they can easily climb on the tree trunk. That's the adaptation only woodpeckers and nuthatches have. Okay, that's about the types of feet. Then bird watching is not only about watching. Sometimes people say watching is through the eyes. But bird watching is also means it's through the ears. So you might be knowing Tansen, who was a very, very good singer, and people still Tansen is the best singer. So you need to be Tansen to understand birds, to listen to the birds. Birds are always calling. Early morning, 5 o'clock, birds start calling around our house, and if you are a Tansen, you can hear them. You can identify what bird it is. So use your ears for bird watching. And now listen to this bird. Okay, sometimes what happens, we hear a lot of birds call. And because we are not familiar with the thing. So you just neglect them. You saw a lot of birds here in this. A lot of those birds. You just neglect. And this was, there are hundreds of house sparrows just outside your house in a tree, and they come every evening for roosting. And till early morning, there is a chorus, and that was what I just played. So we are not able to like combine two things, the call with the bird picture. If you do that, that's good bird watching. Now listen this. And this is, I hope you could hear. And this is our very common bird, like the common tiller bird, which is there in our gardens every time, moving around and cocking its tail. And then one more bird. This is one more common bird. And that's the Asheprinia. And we are not able to many times understand the call and what the bird is, because we never listen to the calls. We always look at the bird as this tiny bird. And now you saw the common tiller bird and you saw the Asheprinia. And these two birds, for a amateur bird, somebody who's starting bird watching, they look so similar. Look at the difference. The tiller birds are greenish upper side and the Asheprinia's gray upper side. Tiller bird has got a beautiful red rufous head. Asheprinia is only ash on the upper side. That's how. Both have similar habits. Both are there in the garden. Both make very similar looking nests. So these are our neighbors. Why do we listen to bird calls? Because it helps. It helps in identification of birds. It also helps in in learning the bird behavior. It helps in knowing what are the alarm calls. And okay, that's the use of the bird calls for us. What is the use of birds? What is the use of those calls and those singing and those alarm calls to the birds? Sometimes, especially in the night, the birds can't see each other. So they need to communicate with each other. So that's why they have their own ringtones, their own calls, like owls, nightjars. They can't see each other. So they need to tell, this is my territory, don't come nearby. So if they want to communicate, or they want a male wants to find a female, or vice versa, they need to communicate, and that's the language. So all the birds, especially which are active in the night, they have, every bird has got a very, very different language. That is the best thing. Okay, one more thing is about, Okay. Another thing is noting important details of these birds when you are watching them. Like the, for example, I am showing three birds. Somebody who doesn't know anything about birds tells me about a bird. I have seen a bird. I went to my farm and there was one parrot-like bird. It was not parrot. It was small. It was green. It was catching insects. Parrots don't catch insects. And this much description tells me it's a green beetle. Or somebody tells me I saw an orangish bird. It was feeding on some grains or something in the agriculture, or you're near my house. But it had a beautiful hairstyle. So I can 100% say he's talking about the Brahmini starling or Brahmini male. And somebody tells me about a bird. He saw the colors were like wings were like a zebra. And it had a beautiful crest on its head. It was eating some insects on the ground and hopping around. So that's the common hoopoe. So there's only few things you describe about the bird, and it's so vivid. So bird identification sometimes involves some observations, regular observations. Because all birds won't stand near in front of you or come to your garden. Some birds will be flying high in the sky. They are known as soaring. They fly high in the sky, and what happens with new bird watchers, when they see a flock of kites, they say eagles. Okay, they are raptors, but kites are very common birds, and once you become a regular bird watcher, you start, you want to see the eagles rather than the kites. So what is the difference between kites and eagles? And when you just look at the bird and you see it's a black kite or a kite, look at the tail first. The tail is curved inside. That's a kite. So when the tail is curled inside, it's a kite. It's not any eagle. So other birds, like there are vultures, look at the tail. It's curled outside. Wings are broad. Huge bird, wings are broad, but the tail is short and curled outside. For the eagles, the tail is longer than the vulture's tail, okay? But the tail is again curled outside. Wings are broad, long, and the ends of the wings are like fingers. Those are known as fingers. Okay, and then there is a kestrel. Kestrels and falcons, they look like triplanes. The wings are pointed, the tail is very long. Birds are very small, like crow size, and tails are very long and again roundish at the ends. So this is known as geese or silot. Just by silot, you should be able to categorize whatever bird it is. Then there are harriers and other birds also, which you need to understand and really remember their silots. When you go birding, you see some birds which look very similar to the birds, with which you are familiar, like the house sparrow. So you see a bird in the grassland which looks like house sparrow, but it's not a house sparrow. Look at the crown, look at the black belly, and it is actually crown feature. And the sparrow male has a gray belly, this has got a black belly. Look at one more bird which looks like a sparrow female, and see the difference. Look at the yellow throat, this is known as yellow throated sparrow, or the new name is chestnut shoulder Petronia. Look at the chestnut shoulder and look at the bar on the wing. There are two bars actually. On the house sparrow female, there is only one bar. So there are very subtle and minute differences. When you look at it, you can identify different birds. There are many types of starlings in our area. I am just trying to show you four types of starlings and minas. So these are four. So they look similar when they are flying, and it is really confusing. But what to look at when you want to identify it? Okay, let us take two of them. So one is common minna, the other is jungle minna. Look at the skin around the eye. The yellow or orange colored skin around the eye, yellow color and the yellow beak. This is a common minna. When it flies, it has a white patch on the wing. So that common minna is very common. Feeds on garbage. Even if you feed roti, it will eat. And then we have the jungle minna. Jungle minna is not so common in cities, but it is there in many cities, okay? Like Delhi, it's there. And this has got a beautiful crest on its over the nose, and the eyes are there is no yellow skin around the eye. That is the suborbital skin. It's not there. Then let us look at the two remaining starlings. One is rosy starling, and the other is Asian pied starling. The Asian pied starling is look at the skin on the face, yellow beak with red base, and the pinkish skin on the cheeks. Rosy starling doesn't have that. Rosy starling is like a glossy bird, pink and black, not shiny, very fast flying and always in flocks, huge flocks, you may see thousands. Okay, so that's the difference. And when the Asian pied starling fly, you see a white bar or a pinkish bar on the wings. Two more birds which look similar. See, they both look similar. Note the posture. One is standing in the erect posture, walking stride. So the right one, which is erect. Sina taan ke chalne wala bird. That is a pipit with the thin bill, and the one with the thick bill is the lark. But why they have thin bill and thick bill? We have seen in the when we are trying to see the different types of beaks. Thick conical beak is for eating grains. So the lark eat grains, and pipit eats insects. That's why the beak is thick, thin for the pipits, thick for the larks. So if you can't see the posture also, if you look at the beak in a photograph, you can say it's a lark. If it is thick beak, and if it is thin, you can say it is a pipit. Okay, and the lark will always be hiding. Pipit will always be walking with sinatanki, with upright posture. So that is the difference in habit and walking style. The two more birds. Some experts are there in today's audience. They will think why we need to compare lesser flamingo and greater flamingo. I tell you, when you see only a flock of only lesser flamingos, many people totally confused whether they are all lesser flamingos or all greater flamingos. I have seen the confusion. So, but when they are standing together, you can easily identify Bada Bhai Chota Bhai, Amitabh Bachchan, and the other, the short guy. that the difference when you see them together. That doesn't happen always in the field. So what is the difference? Look at the beak. The greater flamingo on your left side, the beak is half pink, half black. Dark pink or black. Okay. Just a minute. Of course, lesser flamingo is very short compared to the greater flamingo. Greater flamingo is too tall. It's the Amitabh Bachchan. Okay. And the eye color is different. This has got pale pinkish eye and lesser flamingo has got dark eye. What are the equipments you require for bird watching? Nothing, man. You just go out. You can see the birds. And you can enjoy bird watching. There's nothing you require. But if you want to write down, you repair and diary so that you remember the diary will stay with you. Might be you can make sketches of those birds. I still have sketches of birds I made in the year 2000. And I'm happy that I used to do good sketches. So that will be a good memory as well. And that remains permanent with you. So the bare essence is actually nothing, just a pen and a diary. But if you want to be a better, you want to be better, you just need a pair of binoculars. If you are binoculars, bird watching experience becomes fantastic. Because you can see the birds, you can feel them so near. And of course, having a bird book with you, it helps. And if you have a book of Indian birds, the language ceremonies are used so nice. You will really enjoy bird watching. And to be more sophisticated, what do you need? You add a camera with a good zoom. If you want to go to a higher level, buy a spotting scope. Which binoculars? If you are going to forest for bird watching, or doing birding around your house, get 8x42. 8x42. 8 is the magnification. Look at the figure down. And 42 is the radius of the objective lens, or that is the front lens, farther from your eyes. That's the objective lens magnification. That's the radius of the objective lens. So 8x42. That 8x type is good for forest bird watching. You can easily locate the bird. But if you are always going out to see the weather, seabirds, or water birds, it's always good to have the 10x. So you can see the birds 10 times nearer, and the birds are also, water birds are generally stable. So you have a lot of time to observe them. So either 8x or 10x. Don't go beyond 10x, like 12x. Really, it's very difficult to see the birds through them. Which binoculars? Always people ask. So I will say there are lots of binoculars. I am not working for any company. I am not promoting any brands. But this is just, I am giving three examples. There is Olympus is one of the best. As far I used Olympus for at least 10 years of my life. And Nikon is good. There are a lot of other companies. You have a lot of choices. Internet is there. Please do search. If you want to go beyond 30,000, around 30,000, you can go for Carl Zeiss, and if you have a big budget, like more than 1 lakh, you can of course look for Swarovski. But of course, if I have more money to buy a Swarovski, I will buy a car and Nikon. That will be adjusted in that Swarovski cost. So, and if you are keen in taking your bird watching hobby to a very high level, like what is finding out seabirds, lesser crested tern, greater crested tern, all those we stay far away from you. Buy a spotting scope, good spotting scope. A camera, which camera? There is no end. There is no end. I am just mentioning three cameras: the Nikon P900, Nikon P1000. These have got 83x zoom and 100x optical zooms. So you from a far distance, you can take nice pictures and videos of birds. You don't need to approach the birds. There is Sony also. There are a lot of other options. Again, I am saying I am not promoting anything. And according to budget, also there is a choice of buying SLR cameras. These are digital cameras. SLR cameras where the budget you can have 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 5 lakh, whatever. After you have made his valid hisaps. Okay. And which bird book? Bird books, again, well, this is like, there are lots of books. Okay. But I have seen most of Indian bird watchers use the Birds of Indians subcontinent, on which the blue square helm field cap is known as Grimmett Inskip. So this guide is used by most of the bird watchers. But there is one field guide which is better than that. There is Birds of South Asia, the Ripley guide, written by Pamela Rasmussen. This is the best. Second best is the Grimmett's guide. Of course, third best. And even if you're not using in the field, you should have this book. It's the Book of Indian Birds. And of course, BNSS has the Birds of Indian Subcontinent, which is originally written by the first field guide was by Salim Ali. So this is an adaptation of them. And nowadays, even digital copies of lots of books are available. Android apps are available. So you can use Android apps. And BNSS has, we have introduced Android app. Fortunately, I am looking after the development of this Android app. And that app is known as Internet of Birds. This is the app. So you can see how here, very wise owl. This app is trained to identify 600 species of common birds in India. And the photographs are provided by bird watchers. You can still provide photographs. What you have to do is you have to just open the app, take a picture of the bird in your mobile and submit it. And in 1 second, it tells you what bird it is. And this works very, very, very fantastically well. Try this app if you haven't tried. How do you spot a bird? When I go with bird watchers and there is a bird in the tree and I'm telling, Udhar, right way, left me. This is here, there, Udhar. There is so much chaos. Everybody is confused. So I have this idea. Wall clock on a tree method. Just imagine this wall clock on the tree. Now you can say the bird is there at 3 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 12 o'clock. So the task of telling others where the bird is there actually in the tree has become very easy with this method. So use this method so you don't have to shout much. And how do you dress when you're going out for bird watching? No red, please. Don't wear bright clothes. I'm sure, 100%, I'm damn sure, birds get frightened to colors like this and they fly. If you have dull clothes, I am not saying you wear camouflage clothes, but dull clothes, bird, you can approach the birds better than with the other type of clothes. Birding in forested areas, particularly if you have green clothes, really you can go very near, you can record their bird calls, you can take their nice pictures. But if you are going to a grassland, no, don't wear green, you can wear khakis. Then bird calls, how do you record bird calls? Yeah, you see this guy recording the bird call and he has got equipment that is known as parabola. And I'm sure that costs more than 50,000. I'm not promoting that. I have a simple idea. If you have an Android phone, just download this app, RecForge 2 audio recorder. Okay, just download this app. You can record calls very well. I have played some calls in this presentation. Some of them are recorded by just using this Android app. It's free. It's free and 1 million people have downloaded this and they're using this app. It's very good for bird watching. It's free, very easy to use. You can record in various formats like MP3 or WAV format and so on and so forth. You can edit the calls and you can make beautiful ringtones. How can I help in saving birds? Please contribute your data to citizen science institutes. Because when you watch birds, what is the use of that data? If you're writing in your diary, the diary, I can't see what you are written in your diary. Might be your 1 million records. So contribute your photos to some forum like eBird, Wikipedia, Wikimedia Commons. So others can use. If you are not selling them, if you are selling them, it's all right. You sell. And my best wishes. Write in newspapers, write in magazines, write about birds, write in favor of birds, not against birds. Write in favor of birds so that there is a good environment in India about bird conservation. Write research papers, write short notes about findings of rare birds in your area, where you are bird watching, and what you should not do when you are going out for bird watching. Please do not disturb nesting birds, because that may kill the chicks, that may destroy the eggs, nests. So that ultimately you are killing the birds, you know. So please don't indulge in nest photography. Nobody welcomes nest photography. No Facebook group, no WhatsApp group, no company will entertain any of nest pictures. And don't use bird call replace for bird watching. Don't destroy the bird habitats, because when you have got a gypsy four-wheel drive, you're just taking it into the forest or in a mud flat where the birds are nesting in summer, and you just trample all the eggs of those birds because you don't bother to see what is there at the ground. You are looking far away. So please don't take your SUVs into the birds' habitats and save the birds' human life. For now, I wish you happy birding. Please stay at home, participate in the various birding challenges, take advantage of various online webinars VNHS is hosting, do birding from your window or terrace, follow social distancing guidelines as given by the government. I wish you happy birding. Over to Priyanka.
Yeah. Thank you so much, sir. We will be having question and answer session right now. So those who have questions, one by one, they can ask question. They can unmute themselves to ask question, and they can mute afterwards to listen the answer, obviously. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And one more thing, I have added the link of Internet of Birds mobile application. So you can download through this link. So you can identify the birds with the help of this application. Thank you. Please share on the WhatsApp group which we have created for this.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah, please.
So this is regarding the Oriental Dwarf Kingfisher. So everyone says ki monsoon mein hi dikhta hai. So Where is it found when it is not monsoon? Kahi to rehta hoga.
Yes, it is found in Sri Lanka. It is found in South India from Goa downwards. It's there throughout the year. It comes to it comes for breeding northwards. Like in Mumbai, in CEC it comes on 1st June. Very regular in timing.
But if we go to Sri Lanka or Goa, we would be able to see it year round?
Yes, anytime, yes. Anytime. You can see.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Yes. Thank you so much.
Yeah,
sir. Question from me.
What's your good name?
My name is Atig. ATIG, Atig.
From where?
Mumbai. From Mumbai.
Okay, great. Yeah.
We are your neighbors. We stay in Goregaon.
Yeah.
Because of lockdown, we are communicating through webinar. We can meet.
Yeah. So, the question is more around the fact that you said it's not recommended to mimic bird calls, but I was also looking at some videos by the Cornell Lab of Ornithology, and they said that pishing is not a bad idea. So, what is the difference in opinion? Why is that there? Some people say it is good, some say it is bad.
It's in Western countries, no, US and Canada, they do something known as fishing. Fishing means they just produce the call of a distress call of a bird. That is known as fishing. So this fishing brings out the birds in the bush. It's not required, it's not good. But people do it. I don't recommend that we should do it. That's my opinion. Yes.
Thank you so much.
All birds get frightened because of fishing call.
Understood.
Okay, sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah, okay.
Sir, very interesting class. In this quarantine time, I just started my birding. I actually heard that there is a 15 minute of birding. Means there is something
birding
you
challenge.
Want to 2 minutes, then after that you want to stop your birding. What's actually it means? If we can, I used to bird for 2 hours. I take a first list for 15 minutes only. Then can I add the other birds also in this list?
No. That 15 minutes is for early morning. So just to find out which are the birds which get up early in the morning. You can make another list of those birds which get up later. Like early morning, 5 o'clock to 6 o'clock, you will hear Oriental Magpie Robin, you will hear. And house sparrows. And might be fantails like us, the white spotted, white breasted fantails. These birds 5 to 6 early in the morning, if you are in Mumbai. Mm-hmm. And after 6 o'clock, all the birds will get up. The crows, kingfisher, everything starts calling. So that 5 to 6 mm-hmm. list, no, you should not include birds which get up very late. Okay. So that's the reason. So you make that list 15 minutes or 20 minutes might be, but don't combine the two lists. There is something interesting data. They want to find out.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, very nice question.
Hello.
Very important. Yeah, yeah. Please.
Sir, this is Pratik. I just wanted to ask, like, is there any good location in terms of northeast part of India for the birding? Apart from the Peke or the Kaziranga side, like the Manipur or Arunachal side, do you have any experience in that particular region?
I have done bird watching in Mizoram, Manipur, Assam, a lot of places, not in Tripura, except Tripura, Arunachal. And Mizoram right now, there are not many good guides to take you around in Mizoram, mm-hmm. but it's safe. Okay. Manipur, there are people who can take you around, a little bit not safe. Okay. Other mm-hmm. places are safe. And there are a lot of people going to Arunachal, Assam, we have Kaziranga and so on.
Because I have done in past like a Pakke and Kaziranga, and that too for the clouded leopards, because I am a tiger tracker in Ranthambore, and I have done that so for my personal expedition. But that time I was like amazed to see like lots of birds like with colorful things, and I was like, okay, I just need to do for like the seven sisters for the birding part. So is there any particular specialized time for the birding in for the seven sisters?
You just have to avoid monsoon, that's all. You can go anytime. Monsoon, okay. You just avoid. Just avoid monsoon. Yes. Okay. Any other question? Thanks.
Hello. Hi, sir. Hi, sir. I have a question. This is Sukheti. Yeah. My son is with me. He is Neil. I'll switch on my video. He has a question. He loves to watch birds. Ask me your question.
Where the demigod crane is to see in easily?
What is that? Where is it?
Where we can see easily the demigod crane?
Oh, you can go to Rajasthan, and there are some places where people feed demigod cranes. I think Gujarat also, there are lots of places where you can see demigod cranes. Lots of places.
Kitchen is one of them.
Kitchen in Rajasthan.
Kitchen in Rajasthan. You can see hundreds. Not hundreds, actually, thousands. Then there is Jamnagar in Gujarat, and where Jamnagar also you can see, I have seen 20,000 edges in one place. So you can also see. So should go to those places. Very nice places. Okay.
Thank you.
Nice. Nice you join. All the best to you. Come to CEC Goregaon.
Sorry.
Come to Goregaon to visit our center.
Sure. With
the boy.
Yes.
Hello, sir.
Thank you. Yeah.
Hello, sir. This is Supraja from Chennai.
Yeah, Supraja.
Sir, this session was very useful. In fact, I'm not a bird person yet. I love this session so much. And I also wish you, if you feel comfortable, you can also, I just suggest the thing. You can also organize a butterfly session for armature lepidopterists as well. This is my suggestion, sir.
Great. Priyanka, no doubt. Yes, we forgot to organize for butterflies. We will do it. Okay, taken.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
But we have already planned up to 15th of April, so that will go beyond.
Okay, sir.
Okay,
so hello.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, good sir. Evening.
Hello.
Thank you.
Good evening, sir.
Hello, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Kavan Jadhav.
Good evening, all.
Sir, can I ask something about e-birds, sir? Can you throw some light on e-birds? Myself, Vijay Patil from Panvel.
Oh, Vijay. E-bird, you just go to the website. There are some presentations which guides you about e-bird itself. So it's a website on which you can submit your data of bird watching, and it helps you. I'm talking about what is your benefit. Your benefit is you can make a checklist of what you have seen. You don't need to write everything in diary, because eBird keeps your data. Okay. And you can find out how many birds you saw in the day, how many birds you saw in the month, in the year, in your life.
Yes.
Everything with eBird stores and tells you in a minute. So that's the eBird.
Sir, a request, if possible, please have a session on eBird, please.
eBird, eBird has got a lot of stuff. They can conduct the session. I will request them to have one webinar. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Instead of me conducting, they can.
Hello, sir. This is Pawan Jadhav from Nanded.
Yes, Pawan.
This is Pawan Jadhav from Nanded. Sir, maine जनरली हम देखते हैं कि जो ग्रे हॉर्नबिल है वो पेयर में या एक दो पेयर हो सकते हैं एक जगह पे, राइट? लेकिन मैंने विंटर सीजन में कम से कम 50 या 60 पेयर एक पेड़ पे देखे, ये कैसे हो सकता है सर? मतलब जनरली तो हम दो ही पेड़ ही देखते हैं, तो इतने सारे पेड़ एक ही जगह पे क्यों उसका
और यू आर अ गुड बर्ड पहली बात.
थैंक यू सर. थैंक
यू. सो एंड यू आर लकी
बिकॉज़ आई हैव स्पेंट लास्ट 5 इयर्स I have spent last 5 years and I have been in BNHS for many interviews. I must say. और मेरे दो तीन रिसर्च पेपर भी है, तो वो एक बात है जो मुझे कहीं पर भी मैं सॉल्व नहीं हुई, तो उस क्वेश्चन का आंसर मैं आपसे एक्सपेक्ट करता हूँ.
कौन सा? ये सेम हॉर्नबिल
है.
मेरा पीएचडी है हॉर्नबिल पे, इंडियन ग्रे हॉर्नबिल पे. I have written a book in Marathi as well as in English. You can get the book in Google. So the when the fruiting season is there, and particularly especially in a forest when there is only one tree, huge tree having lots of fruits, then you can see 50-100 birds. I have seen 150 birds in one tree. Okay. Okay. But you are very lucky. That is what I am saying. It's it's a rare thing. It's a rare thing.
Yes. Thank you.
Great.
Good evening, sir. This is Sakshi from Delhi.
Okay, great, Sakshi. Okay.
Sir, I have been seeing hornbills since past 3 weeks in the tree in front of my house. There's a small cavity there. They have been coming daily around 5 to 6 p.m. and they eat fruits there. Along with that, I have seen that when they fly away, the parakeets come to that same cavity. To a pair of parakeets and they occupy that nest. And yesterday I saw that the parakeets and the hornbills are fighting for that nest. So what is this behavior? If you could throw some light on it.
Yeah, this is known as nest competition. So hornbills face a lot of competition from birds, aggressive birds like common minnows and parakeets. Because the nesting cavities are very less and hornbills need cavities. Might be that cavity is perfect for hornbills. But the hornbills will throw the parakeets out. If the nesting cavity is taken by the hornbills, they will nest in it, and they that's why they seal the nest so the parakeets can't disturb them once the nest is sealed. So if you are lucky, they will take the cavity and you will be able to observe the entire breeding cycle. All the best to you. Let us hope they nest in it. The female will seal herself inside the cavity. Okay, keep an eye.
Yes, sir, I read about it.
Early morning, 5 o'clock to 7 o'clock is the time to observe hornbills. So keep an eye.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Great.
Hi, sir. This is again Supraja.
Supraja, yeah. Tell me.
Sir, I came across a photograph where a common kingfisher was eating a green bee eater. Is this a regular sight or it's very rare one, sir?
It's rare. It's rare, but now because we have got so many bird watchers having big cameras, we are getting many multiple pictures of such incidents. It's rare that they feed on birds. It's rare. Yeah, that's a very good photograph. I have seen that. There are 3-4 photographs of kingfishers eating smaller birds.
Yes, sir.
That's a good one. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Thanks so much.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. This is Ramya. Can you share some tips for watching shore birds?
Ramya from where?
Yeah, I'm from Chennai, sir.
Ramya from Chennai.
Yeah.
So the most important thing for watching shore birds is look at the tide timings. Your shore bird watching totally depends on tide timings. Wherever you are going, if it is an intertidal zone, means what tide comes and go, like mud flats or a beach, you should go there when the tide is highest, 1 hour after the high tide. So when the tide is receding, what happens? The high tide brings in all the food, small creatures with it from the ocean and deposits in the intertidal zone. And when the tide is receding, all the migratory birds or the waders come and take benefit of all this new come food, new stock. So every time high tide comes, this is replenished and the waders take it on. So you should go as soon as the high tide is over. But if it is eastern side and western side, then you have to look into those things as well. if it is like Chennai, might be the sun is from the eastern side, so you have to just compare. Might be you, when the high tide is at 3 o'clock, you can go at 4 o'clock and then continue your birding till 7. So sunlight is from your behind, from behind you, so you can see the birds very clearly. In Mumbai, it's just opposite. Okay.
Okay.
So those things you need to consider. But tide timing is most important.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
That's great. Okay, if nobody has questions,
we can take one or two questions and then
Sahib Jeeva, you want to say something?
Sir, I hear that racket-tailed drongo, which imitate other bird sounds also.
Yes. Yes.
So how we can keep the references sound, means how much it is possible. Sometimes we will predict it is something else other than the actual bird.
No, I could not get.
सर मैं ये सुना है कि रॉकेट ट्रेल्ड ड्रोंगो
मेक्स डिफरेंट नॉइज डिफरेंट कॉल्स ओके
तो हम ये बर्ड का साउंड सर आई एम फ्रॉम केरला एक्चुअली हिंदी इज लेस
ओके ओके इंग्लिश ओके ओके आई कुड नॉट गेट द क्वेश्चन आई थॉट
ओके हाउ मच वी कैन यूज साउंड एज अ रेफरेंस फॉर आइडेंटिफाइंग ए बर्ड आई एम आस्किंग अबाउट दैट Means some birds are other sounds also.
Even in the racket-tailed drongos, that is known as a report cry. Report cry is if it is there a racket-tailed drongo is singing, it's singing. If it sings for 1 minute, might be it is giving you making calls of 15 types of birds. Okay, but in between it has got its own signatures. That is known as ringtones. So you can say in simple man's language. So it has got its own signatures in between.
Okay,
so that
okay.
signature you can identify, and that put combination of 15 calls at that particular slightly harsh call. So you can with experience you can say it is racket-tailed drongo, because the same list of bird calls imitated by racket-tailed drongo will not be imitated by other birds. Like there is long-tailed shrike. Long-tailed shrike will be imitated different calls because it is in grasslands. Racket-tailed drongo always in a forest bird, so it will imitate birds which are there in the forest. So the list of bird calls which it is imitating is very different, and its own call frequency is different. So that's how we can still identify. A lot of people can easily identify a racket-tailed drongo, and they will tell you, yes, it is a racket-tailed drongo. But of course, sometimes it confuses. It can even make the call of your camera shutter going.
I heard that some people went to forest by searching some cats, forest cat, but cat sound and they get confused. They actually think that this cat is nearby, but actually that was racket-tailed drongo.
Oh yes, yes, that happened to me also. Yes, that's right. That's very, very true. Very true. Yeah, thanks. Thanks.
Okay, so I guess we can take one last question, and then if you have any questions, you can mail us. I am putting our email address in the chat section, so you can mail us. So Atig, you can ask
question. No, I mean I don't have a question. It's just that since you're recording this, are you going to share this somewhere? Can we get that? Because yes, sir has actually talked about too many things. Sab kuch dimag mein yaad nahi hai.
Yeah. So we are trying to share it on YouTube. So we will share the link with us once we upload or the audio on YouTube.
Madam, can I ask ask a last question, please?
Yeah, you can ask the last one.
Sir, I am Vijay Patil. I want to know where do the birds go when they die? Because there were some interesting theories on WhatsApp University. So can you throw some lights on it?
There are some stupid writing such very nice articles. It just totally brainwashes us. All animals which take birth, they have to die. They die just like all other animals. I will show you crows and pigeons everywhere dead on the roads. Everywhere you can see dead birds. That was all bullshit written by such some fellow. So please don't believe in that. All animals have to die one day. So birds also die. Okay, there is nothing. They go to sky and die in a secret place, or go to heaven directly. Nothing, boss. This is a simple science. Okay. Yeah, Vijayji, please.
Sir,
birds also die just like any other animal. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. sir. Thanks. Thank you very much.
You are welcome. All are welcome.
Okay, so